the night sky. At least since the emergence of consciousness in man, the night sky has inspired awe. And ever since man developed a mind, the night sky has provoked thought, and it has been calling for interpretation. In this episode, we will briefly explore how astronomy, after over at least 2,000 years of development of interpretations of the observed motions of celestial bodies, culminated in the first modern formulation of laws of nature in terms of a system of differential equations. The publication of these by Newton in 1687 is considered to represent the completion of the scientific revolution. As we shall argue, this at least foreshadowed the Industrial Revolution, which, in its turn, would drastically change the very face of planet Earth.
Welcome back. The title of this episode is a brief introduction to celestial mechanics, and we shall consider it an application of theory of a system of coupled nonlinear differential equations, ordinary differential equations, that will be, so just describing functions of time. So let's immediately have the first introductory slide. what I have in mind with this episode is to present that we will kind of come full circle regarding everything that we have been doing throughout the course and all the previous episodes. And I have several goals in mind with this. First of all, we shall return to nonlinear differential equations. So until this point, essentially, except in the very early beginning of the course, we have been building upon linear theories, bringing in all kind of reasoning that were available actually and familiar from linear algebra. Now by taking a look at nonlinear differential equations in this episode, you will have the effect of contrast, and that will also highlight our experiences that we had with all these linear theories. We could build and develop episodes on end, having a thread connecting all those things. And that was all that all had to do with linearity. Now, today we will have a rather different atmosphere, a rather different style of working with differential equations, and that has to do with the fact that they are non-linear. So we will have an effect of contrast, and that should serve you to better see what linearity really brought us, all those episodes that we did, and maybe you'll even appreciate the linearity. However, also in another sense, we will come a full circle, because we will see again key players from very early in the course. Those were integrating factors. We will also once again meet the harmonic equation in the very central, that has a very central position in the celestial mechanics that we will consider. So that is a very nice highlight of today also, to recognize the harmonic equation once again. And furthermore, we have been proceeding throughout the history of differential equations up to the point last time when we even met scientists from quantum mechanics, so 20th century minds. But today we shall return to the very genesis of differential equations, and that happened with basically the publication of Newton's Principia in 1687. So good 300 years ago, all this developments of the kind of mathematics that we have been studying started. So it is also nice that by the end of this course we do return to the very roots of everything that we have been working on. And it will also show that really great minds have been working on all this material that we did study in this course since at least the 17th century, so for a good 300 years. And I shall, by the end of this episode, yet again quote an exemplifying result of this that ties together many concepts that we met throughout the course. So, that is another way that we will come full circle. So here's an outline for what I have in mind to do throughout this episode. So we will concentrate on celestial mechanics. And as I said, it all started with Newton's Principia, in which he presented his new view on how the world, the universe is constructed, and how the motions of the planets in the solar system are to be understood and interpreted. So we will go into that, because that really was what brought us differential equations. And that is actually this book, this is Newton's Principia. This is a translation in English. The original publication was in Latin in 1687. This is the first translation in English. This is from 1729. And here we have Newton, by the way. And as I will very briefly show, this book has been of an enormous influence, likely, on the development of civilization. And it has been interpreted as the completion of the so-called scientific revolution. And we will see in a minute what likely the impact of that has been. So it is of such importance that I think it is worthwhile to spend a few slides having a look at that. And then I will briefly try to indicate what it did bring, and try to indicate how it could be so influential. And in explaining that, I will follow another book. This concept is not, this topic is not covered in Boyce and De Prima. Boyce and De Prima did refer to this book, which is Introduction to Ordinary Differential Equations by Earl Coddington, Lord Coddington, a member of the House of Lords. And he did cover this. I ran into this book actually when I studied Frobenius theory, and Boyce and De Prima referred back to this book for that. And then I read also that Earl Coddington covers Newton's Principia and what Newton actually did. And that brought me to this. So when I was reading Coddington about that, it was still not exactly clear what Newton had exactly done, and that is how I came to get myself a copy of the Principia itself. That is this. How I found out what really happened in the Principia, and what I learned about that. It happened about a year ago that I studied that. I'd like to share with you in this episode today. And as we will see, Newton in the Principia presented his laws of motions, and he went back and forth. And that is one of the messages that I did get from Coddington. It is a different style of working than what we are used to in mathematics courses, when you have this is the equation, how to solve it, and you have a method or a theory of a procedure to produce the answer of differential equation or initial value problem or what have you. What Coddington pointed out, what he emphasized, and that is how I became aware of that, and that indeed it so happens in the Principia, as Newton goes back and forth. He is adjusting his approach, solving and studying a differential equation and its solutions and the dependence on parameters to make progress as regards scientific predictions and scientific knowledge that is out there. So we will see that. So it's a different style of working, and I think that is actually what explains how he could be so enormously influential. So that is certainly a worthwhile hearing about, and that is what I have in mind. So that is roughly the outline of this presentation. So we will see Kepler's laws, the empirical laws as found by Kepler by observation, about how the planets move and how Newton moved back and forth between his theory and that empirical knowledge to arrive at the results that he had. And it is really the universal law of gravitation that is his central result. And once again, because this course is meant for aerospace engineering, that is another reason why I think it is worthwhile to spend this episode on finding out what exactly the meaning of that universal law of gravitation is. Because after all, if you do space flight, that is the force field in which you are navigating. So it is just worthwhile to spend at least one episode studying differential equations in Newton's way, in the original way, to find out the meaning of what gravitation in the classical mechanics really tells us. Now, and then as a kind of a concluding subject towards the end of the episode, I will just quote the solution from the literature since Newton that covers the problem of how does a planet move as a function of time. We will not spend much time and effort on that, because that is really a specialism in aerospace engineering, to calculate orbits of satellites and spacecraft and what have you. So you probably know more about this than I do. But still, I would like to quote this result, because it again ties together a lot of results that we have established in the course of this series of episodes on differential equations. And I will stop with a brief reflection. So far from for the outline and the goals. So let's go for it. And I would like to start showing a graph of the history of the world population. So this graph actually shows the count of human people on Earth since 10,000 years ago. And it is on an exponential scale. And I have made some attempt to explain the features that you do see in this curve. And mind you, it is indeed on a logarithmic scale. So we have here 1 million, 10 million, 100 million, 1 billion and 10 billion. So we are in modern times. We are now about 7.5 billion people on Earth. And 10,000 years ago, there was just 1 million people walking the planet. And there's keywords here that kind of explain how the population grew and why it grew. So this is 10,000 years ago, was the Stone Age. But the invention of agriculture caused exponential growth of the world's population. And it apparently remained stable for quite some time. But inventions like cities and more modern technology like metals, bronze, writing, so culture, iron, more advanced technologies, kind of allowed humankind to multiply and expand. So here we are in the Roman Age. And let's zoom in on this area, which is then since Roman times. Here's a zoom in. So we see a steady growth of the world population. throughout the Middle Ages, you might say. There's the plague, which was an infectious disease, and that was really harsh. It lasted for some. This is 100 years. So we have here a period of a few hundred years, and it has been estimated to have killed about 200 million people on the total population of 500 million. So that was a true disastrous times. And then here, this is the modern time. So you see, the character of growth really has kind of an elbow down here. So there was a dramatic change in the expansion of your human population. And that is likely explained by the Industrial Revolution here. And that is kind of foreshadowed by the Scientific Revolution. And that is really what, if you search some easy to read sources from the history of culture and civilization, the Scientific Revolution is a period in like the 17th century, where mankind started to develop real new ways of thinking. And the Newton's Principia, this book was published in 1687, is considered as being the completion of the Scientific Revolution. So this graph kind of suggests that the Scientific Revolution and the publication of the Principia being a kind of a completion of that, a landmark, kind of foreshadowed the Industrial Revolution, and that led to this enormous exponential growth in the population, so the number of human people living on Earth. So that is kind of a suggestion in a plot to illustrate the kind of impact that at least the change in way of thinking that happened in that time likely has had. Now that calls for an explanation, and I will make a brief attempt to say something about that by reflecting on the content of the Principia by way of doing the differential equations that are in there, solving them, but try to follow Newton's footsteps and explain what he did and how he did it and why that was so impressive and may have influenced mankind's thinking since then so much. Now one more graph about the world population, that is the last 150 years, just to show how impressive such an elbow is on a logarithmic scale. So you really see a feature here. If we zoom back out, you really see that this is fundamentally, qualitatively a different area than all the areas that have been before. It really curls up. Really spectacular phenomenon showing up, and it doesn't easily happen on a logarithmic scale, and that is demonstrated by this plot. I mean, we all know the world wars. Well, the first world war was here, and the second world war was between 1940-1945, and in spite of the fact that these were really phenomena on a gigantic scale with tremendous horrors and about 80 million people, 40 million people killed in the First World War and twice as many in the Second World War. Such phenomena hardly show up or not at all in such a curve on a logarithmic scale. So that tells you that if you do see a phenomenon on these kind of plots, then there really something happened. Really something happened. So once again, I think nice to have in mind what the impact has been of developing the way of thinking that we shall try to capture in this episode. So just a background. Now, then what was it? So in 1687, so we're about this time indeed, here was published this book by Isaac Newton, who had been pushed a little bit. He was in his 40s when he published this. He had been pushed by the Royal Society to come up with a publication because now maybe that was a matter of national pride. Newton was not the only known scientist to have been thinking about these things and to have results about these things. Also on mainland Europe there was Leibniz, and there will be forever discussion about who actually is to be credited for what in these matters. But whatever the outcome of that discussion may be, Newton was pressed to come up with a publication, and he wrote in a few years' time this book, The Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy and a System of the World. And that presented his theory of dynamics, laws governing motion, and we will see in a minute how they came about. What he did, so he did three things. He presented the theory of dynamics, and then, as we will see, that is to be emphasized, he applied his theory of dynamics to interpret what was known in astronomy, and most notably Kepler's laws. And we will see what those are. And those are statements about how the moon moves about the Earth, how the planets move around the sun, and also the moons of Jupiter and Saturn that could be observed by then by telescopes, how those move around their planets. So there were all kind of motions moved in the heavens. And empirical knowledge, quite accurate time series had been observed and documented. And laws had been formulated summarizing those results. Those were Kepler's laws. And Newton applied his dynamics to interpret those. And we will see exactly what he did and what he arrived at. Furthermore, he applied it to comets, and those may make a very different kind of motions than the planets, and also to the tidal motions of the oceans on Earth, so the motion of the water under influence of the gravitation of the sun and the moon. And carrying out this program, so combining theory and making predictions and confronting his theory with observed knowledge, he derived his universal law of gravitation, which was kind of a summary of the explanation of his picture of how the solar system, for example, actually works, and how the motions in that are to be interpreted. Now we will see how that comes about. Now, just one remark still, because I did show the enormous impact that this may have had, that is suggested to have had on civilization and the Industrial Revolution that came about, and really the face of the Earth seems to have been changed by this and the aftermath of this. And you wonder, how can that be? That cannot be just a result of somebody being able to calculate the motions of the planets. And indeed, as we will see, and as I will try to demonstrate, there is more here. It is not just because It is not just about reconstructing the motions of the planet. It's not just about solving some differential equations. He really presented the modern scientific approach. And there is indeed in the Principia documentation of rules of reasoning in philosophy, and philosophy meant the science, scientific thinking. And it has a few components. First of all, he was very clear and really of a mathematical character in his theory. So this was really a rational theory, very precise, making calculations and mathematical derivations. And as we will see a few examples, comparing his predictions in a quantitative, precise way with what was known from observations. So that is one. But I think what is also very important is his theory is really a theory in terms of cause and effect. And actually, cause and effect is a very, very powerful thing. And that can be traced back to the ancient Greek philosophers. And I would like to mention Aristotle here. And let me just read a few words from Aristotle. This is an English translation, Aristotle. The book is called The Metaphysics. And he's writing about all kinds of words that we use, like substance and property and the meaning of false. Completeness, substance, relative, quality, quantity, those kind of concepts that we often use in scientific thinking and scientific knowledge. Those kind of concepts were thought over by Aristotle, and he wrote about that. And here's a book that is called Book Alpha, where he writes about the causes. And the chapter is called Wisdom as being the knowledge of causes. It starts like this. All men, by their very nature, feel the urge to know. That is clear from the pleasure that we take from our senses, from their own sake, irrespective of their utility. Above all, we value sight. Disregarding its practical uses, we preferred. So he writes, we really enjoy looking around, observing things and learning about the world just by looking at it. And that is how you get knowledge about the world. So, but that is what he says. He says, why do we enjoy being able to see so much? Well, because sight is the principal source of knowledge and reveals many differences between one object and another. So that is knowledge. And then he starts analyzing knowledge, and he writes about animals also being able to see. And then the chapter ends with this sentence. Actually, the present point is that all agree that we ordinarily call wisdom to be concerned with first causes and principles. We consider an experienced man wiser than one who has only sensation, because it is clear that wisdom is the knowledge of certain principles and causes. So he makes a distinction between wisdom and knowledge. Knowledge is what you get just looking at things. Wisdom has to do apparently with understanding. And what he emphasizes is that wisdom has to do with knowing about principles and about causes. So that is the answer about why do things happen. That is what the cause has to do with the why question. And so ever since Aristotle, question of why, cause and effect, has been a central one in philosophy and in understanding. And as we shall see, Newton's approach to dynamics can be appreciated in that sense, that he was the first to come up with a theory that was both mathematically precise and allowed rational reasoning and making quantitative predictions that could be confronted with scientific quantitative observed data. But it was also a theory in terms of cause and effect. And in that sense, it had just the explanatory power that Aristotle had in mind. And that might be an explanation why it is so appealing. And it was such appealing to everybody who saw that it was so powerful. It was it both appealed to the need in people to explain things and have an answer on the kind of why questions, so ask for the reason why things happen, and it was mathematical and rational. And another thing that he did, what we will see, is that he used the idea of idealization, so every now and then appreciate results because they suggested a kind of an ideal, nice results. We will see an example of that, and that can be traced back to Plato, actually, also an ancient Greek philosopher. And then once again, he was the theory is mathematical clear, but he also moved back and forth between theoretical predictions and a really accurate observation of data. So, and I think this combination might explain why the new science that was picked up and developed after Newton was inspired by this turned out to be so successful and helped enable the Industrial Revolution. And that might help explain why the world changed so much starting around 1700, so around the time that this work was published and appeared. So let's keep this in mind while we study the content of the Principia. And this is just a photograph of one page. This is Newton himself, so you might care to use your pause button to take a look at what is written here. But the reason why I show it is just to give an impression of Newton's character, what kind of man he was. He seemed to have been quite down to earth and 2 feet on the ground. This is a preface to a third edition of the Principia. There's really a picture of a page in this book. And he writes things like, well, there has been observed another comet, and it has been done precisely in the orbit of that comet was observed somewhat more accurately than before. Calculations have been done to work out the data and compare it with the theoretical prediction, and all those new data and calculations have been taken care of in the preparations of the third edition of the Principia. So it is really down to earth and quite clear mind. Newton, is Newton. So just to give you an impression of what kind of man he was. And also it is kind of fresh if you read this text, it is very readable. Although it is was published in 1725, so 300 years ago. Now, let's see. So, Newton's axioms and laws of motion. So, once again, this is really a photograph of the Principia itself. The chapter is called Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy, and he starts defining concept of motion itself. I think that is really important. So he has these definitions, and he says, well, we need a measure of the amount of matter, and he spent some time writing about it, and then once you have an idea of the amount of matter, you can define the amount of motion, because that is just the product of velocity and the amount of matter together. So so once he has defined the amount of motion, being the product of mass, as we will call it now, and but that will come in some more detail, because it is important to understand what Newton meant by mass, and what the role of that is in his theory. And then he proceeds, now that we know the amount of motion, he proceeds to present his axioms or laws of motion, and there's three of them, all in one page actually. So we have the first, second and third law of motion of Newton, all on one page here. And let's see what happens. So he starts in the first law to introduce the concept of inertia, and it has to do with his concept of mass. And now, as you might know from other courses on mechanics, introduction of mechanics, Newton's laws apply with respect to suitable coordinate systems. So you need, in aerospace engineering, you need to use a coordinate system that is fixed with respect to the stars, the distant stars. That's called an inertial frame of reference. And you need to measure time with a good clock, or by having a good reference in the heavens. But Newton's universe has an absolute sense of time, so everybody should be able to measure time and agree on that. So time in the Newtonian mechanics is a parameter. So we have parametric, we expect parametric descriptions of position of a planet that would be indicated by a position factor r, and that would depend in a parametric way on time, and the time is something that you can measure with a clock, and there should be no confusion about what is meant by time, and everybody should agree on what the value of time is at any desired moment of interest. So that is a starting point, the frame, the universe, the Newtonian universe, frames of inertia, frames of reference, and absolute time. And then we had this amount of motion. So if you have position of position pointed, denoted by a vector, a position vector, and that depends on time. You can take the derivative with respect to time, that would give you the velocity. So given the modern mathematics that we have, that is for us quite straightforward. So we have velocity here multiplied by this mass, which is the amount of matter that Newton started talking about on the previous page that I showed. And he says in his second law, well, if, and that is that cause and effect kind of reasoning, he says if the amount of motion is to change, then that needs to be explained. There is a why question, why would the amount of motion change? And that needs to be explained, so there has to be a cause for that. And that is his very concept of force. And that is introduced here. And that is why in his first law he starts to emphasize that. And that is also because historically there had been a lot of discussion about the concept about these concepts, about what changes in nature needed to be explained, what was persistent and what was not. Well, his axiom for dynamics was, this is velocity, but the amount of motion is the product of the amount of matter and velocity, and this quantity together would be amount of motion, and if that changes, that needs to be explained. So then you need to come up with a force that is this quantity, and that should equal the amount of change the rate of change of the amount of motion. That is what he did. And furthermore, it is emphasized, and we do that in boldface, that all these quantities are vectors. So forces can be added like vectors. And that is what happens actually in the third law. That is, if two particles exert a force on one another, like the sun and a planet do, the sun is pulling on the planet, and then it must be such that the planet will also pull on the sun. I will come to that, why that was absolutely needed in the Newtonian mechanics, why he did need this law. I'll come to that in a minute. But that is his third law. Whenever there is a force from one particle acting on another one, so we have a number of particles and we count them by indices. If there is a jth particle, so the third acts on the fifth, then the force of the third on the fifth is exactly opposite to the force that is exerted by the fifth on the third. And those are vectors. So they could be, they can be compared, and they can even be added up to zero. So you could, in the calculus, you could apply the calculus of vectors here, and that is where this minus comes from. If you would add those vectors up, then the result would be zero, because one is the negative of the other. So these are really vectorial quantities, and he spends many pages on explaining the concept of vectors. We don't need to do that. We don't need to do that because these are just the vectors that we are used to from linear algebra. With a remark that that will come. Now some remarks about all that. Once again, it is very important for what is coming to understand what this mass m means. So it is really defined here by means of those two laws. Mass is really the property of matter to resist against change of motion. So if I push something, that is the force, then that object will accelerate, so the amount of motion will change. But the more mass there is, the more force is needed to get that acceleration, to establish that acceleration. So mass is really inertia, the property of matter to resist against change of what is called momentum, so the amount, Newton's amount of motion, the product of mass and velocity. And that is a contrast with the ancient notion that had been proposed and accepted since Aristotle again, who thought that to keep motion going there is a force needed. So if something is moving at all, then there has to be a force that causes that motion and that maintains that motion. So it was the ancient understanding of how the universe worked was, if you change the position of something, so velocity, that needs to be explained, otherwise things would stay where they are. So if position changed, that needed a cause. And Newton proposes another point of view. He says no, if nothing would, no force would act on the moon, it would just go on forever throughout the universe. And it is really the change of motion that needs to be explained, and that is what he called force. So, but it is very important to understand M is inertia, the property of matter to resist against change of amount of motion. And we will come to that. And then this third law that he had, if two particles pull on one another, those forces are exactly opposite, and they would add up to zero. Why is that needed? Well, by that time it had been possible to observe Jupiter and his moons, for example, Jupiter and the moon, there and its moons all pull on one another, and the planet pulls on the moons. So in that system, there's all kind of interactions, forces acting on those particles among one another. And yet, if you follow that system over the weeks, months, and years, you do notice that Jupiter and its moon just move along in an orbit around the sun, and their mutual interactions seem to have no influence on that at all. But to explain that, you need this. You need to be able to say, well, if I add up all those interactions, that cancels out, because any force has a counterforce in that system that is exactly opposite. And if you add all those forces up, you end up with a total force of zero. So the sum of the forces of a system as it exerts on itself is zero. And therefore, the internal interactions of Jupiter and its moons have no influence on the orbit of that whole system of Jupiter and its moons around the sun. So that is absolutely needed. This law is absolutely needed if you accept this, and to reconcile that with the observed motions of planets like Jupiter and together with its moons. And again, that was a bold step to say if somebody pushes something, that something will also push back. And that Newton mentions pulling a rope between two people. You pull, but you also feel that a pull. But that was in contrast with Aristotle's ancient view that if there is a cause causing a motion, then it cannot be that very cause is also affected by that itself. That was a one way. The ancient view of cause and effect of Aristotle was a kind of a one way affair. The cause causes an effect, but not reversely. And with Newton, there is this symmetry. But it was needed before to explain this. And we will meet it again when we derive Newton's general law of gravitation. This has great consequences. So it is worthwhile now to understand exactly these concepts and why they are there, why they must be there. Because they have rather unexpected consequences, as we will see. But let's move on. Now, what you need to do for the rest is derive the center of mass system and equivalent dynamics of a two-body system in polar coordinates. But now for aerospace students, I will assume that you are familiar with those from other courses, and otherwise you can consult my reader. I have a manuscript that has all the details, also these details, but I will not cover them in this presentation. Our overview is here. If you apply Newton's first, second and third laws and to two particles that move along one another and interact by a force, you can show by change of variables that that is equivalent to the motion of one single particle among a center of mass of the two particles. That can be derived from the three laws of Newton. By the way, if you do that in detail, that again explains why the solar system or Jupiter and its moons or Saturn and its moons can move as a whole. That is again a story that I just discussed, the consequences of the third law of Newton. And then, but if you then express the dynamics of that system in polar coordinates, you arrive at these differential equations, and those we will study. So this describes the dynamics of the distance between two particles, r, effective distance, and the angle of that. And it looks as the dynamics of a single particle being at the distance of the center of mass So that is the mass average, the position of two particles, that is the center of mass. And this r is the distance with respect to that of an equivalent particle. And the motion of that is described by these equations in polar coordinates. So a distance from the center and an angle, but we will have a picture in a minute. And it is pulled by a force, that is the interactive force between the two particles, but now that there is an equivalent force field, and that has a radial and a angular component, and that is the meaning of these subscripts. And there can be no confusion because we will not work with partial derivatives. So subscripts in this episode do not mean partial derivatives, they are just the components, and we have a radial and an angular component of the force between the particles, or equivalently the force acting on the equivalent particle is in a radial direction and an angular direction, and those components are these components of the force F. M denotes the equivalent mass. We will see it late in the episode, the formula for that, when we need it briefly. And otherwise, these are the differential equations of Newton for the motion of such a mass. And this is a system of equations. So we have two differential equations here that makes it the system. So there's nothing mysterious about that. System of differential equations is just having multiple differential equations that share variables. That is what we see here. And we have two variables, r and theta, both depend on one independent variable t. So it is ordinary differential equations, and they are nonlinear because we do observe products of the variables. So we have a system of coupled nonlinear ordinary differential equations here. Now, again, the derivation of this in all detail you could find in the reader that I have available, but we will start from this. Focusing, like Newton did, to derive Kepler's laws of motion for the planets, and those have been published early in the 17th century by Kepler in 1609. And those are these two laws, observable laws, published by Kepler. And the first says planets move in elliptical orbits. And the second says in equal times the radii of planets, so from the center of mass, which is in practice nearly the sun, to the planet moves, and then that radius traces out a segment, and the area of that segment is the same in equal amounts of equal intervals of time. So now that was what Kepler had arrived at, and what he published in 1609. The first and second law. To appreciate that, maybe I should mention that when he published this, he gave up especially the first law, that planets move in elliptical orbits. He had to give up about 2,000 years of astronomy, and that was all based on a very old principle that can be traced back to Plato in the Timaeus. And I have here the collected works of Plato, and hardly any of this is a thick bundle. This is everything that Plato wrote, and there's hardly anything. There's only one work of Plato that considers cosmology, and that is Timaeus, where a stranger is a guest at the school of philosophy. That is the stage of the play. Timaeus, and he tells how the universe was constructed and how it came into being. And from that it becomes clear that why the heavens and the sun and the moon and the planets are there in the first place. And the reason for that is that when the universe was constructed, before that there was nothing, there was no space and time. And in order to create time, that was the very reason why the sun was there, because the sun defines the year, the moon defines the month, and the planets also have their role in defining time. So they were put in the heavens in circular orbits, obviously, and there's no time spent in the Timaeus explaining why those have to be circles, but that is kind of self-explanatory because it is mentioned that the Creator looked at perfect mathematical world when he created the heavens, and you can tell because it is so beautiful, that it is such a perfect construction that there's hardly a question about what the shape of the orbits must be. There must be circles. And now what I want to draw your attention to is that this reasoning says if the moon, the sun and the planets are there to define time, then by definition the motion of the planets in their orbits must be uniform. They must move with uniform velocity because they are the very definition of time themselves. So since Plato, that had been the principle by means of which astronomers interpreted the phenomena that they did observe in the heavens with greater and greater accuracy and more data documented over the centuries. So until Kepler, astronomers had been working on interpretations of the motions in terms of perfectly uniform circular motions. And now early in the 17th century, Kepler again was working on data on the planet Mars, and he had spent months of calculations reconstructing the motion of Mars in this manner. And then he confronted it with very accurate and very detailed data that he had, and he managed to get it right up to an accuracy of 8 arc minutes. But he was convinced actually that his data was better than that. So he was forced to a conclusion by an error of 8 arc minutes that he had to give up this 20 centuries old idea that it had to be explicable in terms of uniform circular motions. Now, if you imagine what 8 minutes looks like at the sky, if you go out in a dark night and look at the moon, it looks rather like a rather big object. But if you measure the size of the moon in the heaven by taking it between your fingers, it is kind of the size of a pea at the arm length. So it is actually quite small. And that is 31 arc minutes. So the error that Kepler had in his prediction of the position of Mars, the planet Mars in the heavens, was only a quarter of the size of the moon. And in his days, that was for him of sufficient discrepancy between the theory and the data that he had to be forced to reject the possibility of explaining that motion and that position of Mars at that particular time in terms of circles. And that is how he was forced to try elliptical orbits, and that was such a success that he published that, and since then that had been known as Kepler's first law. But the motion was also non-uniform, so the planets moved in elliptical orbits but not with constant velocity. So that was kind of a disaster, because it kind of destroyed the notion that the motions in the heaven were regular in terms of defining time. And for that reason, it must have been an enormous relief to him that he discovered that actually the areas that are swept out by the radii from the sun to the planets, if you measure the area of such a segment swept out in an equal amount of time, the areas are the same. So that then provided the new definition of time and the notion of things being regular in some sense. So these were enormously important laws, especially the second one that really saved the idea that there should be some regularity in the motions in the heaven. So this was what was known from very accurate observations in astronomy when Newton started confronting his theory by this. And here we go. Now we go come to the mathematics. So once again, from preparations, Newton's laws for an equivalent motion of a particle. Here it is. The black dot denotes some planet, say. And the coordinate is the radius to the center of mass. And an angular position over there. It is theta depending on time. And those quantities apparently satisfy this differential equation for some force that has a radial component Fr, which should be along this radial vector, and that in itself denotes the position of the planet, and it might have a component F theta that would be along this direction, perpendicular to R, but in the direction that you get if you vary theta here. If you would vary theta, you would go in that direction. That is the direction then of F theta, so the direction perpendicular to the radius of the position of the planet. And the differential equations are there. So as I said, a coupled system of nonlinear differential equations and two components of force that are not given. So when Newton started working on it, he had this principle that there should be an explanation for a change of motion that had to be a force, that had to be a vector, but that was all that he assumed. What is to be explained is the change of amount of motion. There must be a force, but we don't know what it is. And what he does is go and reconstruct what that force looks like, given everything that is known about the motions in the heavens. So essentially given the laws of Kepler. Now here we go. And now we meet an old friend, I would say. From very early in the course, we had these integrating factors. Now these are nonlinear equations, as I said, so there's no such thing as methods that I can offer to you, stepwise algorithms, how to proceed with such equations. But sooner or later you might get inspiration and try integrating factors, and this equation has one. If you multiply the second equation by r, that you get this, so mr squared theta double derivative plus 2r times the first derivative theta derivative would be, and also multiply the right hand side by r times f theta, so the angular component of the force. And it so happens that r is an integrating factor, which is one of the reasons why I cover integrating factors early in the course. We need it here, you know what it is. It means if you have an integrating factor, and in this case we have no recipe for how to obtain it, but what does it mean? Well, if you multiply your equation, then you can fold it together, and that is what happens here. This left-hand side happens to be equal to the derivative of this quantity, which is easy to check if you have the ddt operator act on theta. You get theta prime, you get theta double prime still multiplied, and because of the product rule, we also would have to take the time derivative of this prefactor, which is 2r times, and then for the chain rule r prime. So this the product rule and the chain rule both applied to explain why this left hand side indeed is the derivative of this quantity. So once you multiply this by r, you can integrate the left hand side, and that is what is done, and the result is in this green box here. And then Newton had this, and he made the following observation. He said, well, given this coordinate system, this quantity actually is proportional to this area. Why is that? Well, if I change theta over time, that is the rate of change of theta is this theta prime. So theta changes a little bit. If I multiply this by the length, then r times theta prime is the velocity that I get here. That is the velocity with which the planet moves in perpendicular direction to this R. And then this little triangle that is then formed between the old and the changed position of the planet, this triangle is half a rectangle, and the area of that rectangle would be R times this side. So that R squared theta prime that we have is twice that the area of that segment. So that is twice the segment that is swept out by the radius, by the position factor of the planet, if theta moves a little bit in a small but finite amount of time, that would be, or even in an infinitesimal amount of time, that this product is a measure for the area of that segment. And Kepler's laws, second law, says those segments are constant. And in any instant of time, the segment swept out, the area of that segment swept out by this position factor is the same. Now, that is exactly what you would get if the right-hand side of this equation would be zero. Then the equation would say, well, the time rate derivative of this quantity would be, and that is that segment, proportional to that segment, that would be constant. So the conclusion is, derived from Newton's dynamics, that if the gravitational force, the force acting on this planet, would be such that it is just along this direction, so from the planet to the center of mass, which that is, given the preparations that we did, and that's called the central force. If the force has no component in the direction perpendicular to the position vector of the planet under the particle under study. So if the force is central, so if this component is zero, then this quantity is conserved. So it is a constant. We call that L. It is the component, as it is called, the angular momentum in the plane in which we are working. So we work in a two-dimensional setting here. The component of the angular momentum in that plane is conserved. And that is essentially, as we discussed, equivalent to Kepler's second law of the planetary motions. So once again, Newton starts from his dynamics, saying if there is a changing amount of motion, then there must be a force explaining that and being the cause of that change. And now he starts deriving mathematically in a differential equation like fashion, calculation, solving a differential equation and then confronting it with what is known about the solution, and he arrives at this conclusion that the force must be central in order for his theory to render Kepler's second law. Now, I copy these results to the next slide. So we will again have these equations, Newton's equations themselves, with the result that the theta component of F will be zero, and we will copy Kepler's second law in this mathematical form that Newton derived. So let's move on to see how Newton treated recovered Kepler's first law using the second law, and that is the law of closed elliptical orbits, and what his conclusions were from confronting his theory with that law. Now, so I've copied from the previous slide once again Newton's laws of motion, now taking into account that the angular component of the force was zero, because he had already concluded that the force must be central. And then in the right box over here, I have again a copy of the second law of Kepler. So this conservation of angular momentum, essentially. And from that you can make this step. You say, well, if then theta prime would appear as it does in the motion equations of motion, then I could eliminate that, because I could just take everything to the other side. I would get L over M times 1 over R squared, and that is minus the derivative of ddr. that will turn out to be a profitable form to write it. But you can also, of course, say, well, it is just L over M over R squared. But in either case, you can use equation number 3, that conservation law, you can use that to eliminate one variable from the other differential equations. Now, that is a kind of a general tactic that is good to keep in mind, because every now and then that is applicable. If you have a conservation law, you can take advantage of that in this way, eliminating variables. So, that is one thing. Now, another thing that we will do, because it still looks quite complicated to solve these equations, an idea that you might have sooner or later is, well, would it be possible to conceive a planet moving in its orbit in the following way? I have a radius, a distance from the center of mass, a distance from the sun, say. And could it be that we can conceive that distance as being a function of the angle, the polar angle, and then that polar angle being a function of time, and that would be it, that there would be no other direct time dependence needed for the radius. So R depending on time would be a two-step thing. R depends on theta, and theta depends on time. Could that be possibly a solution of the way in which we could describe solutions of those equations? And if so, then you could later say, well, then I first have, apparently, even if I would not know how theta depends on time, then I still would know how R depends on theta. So I would have a description of the shape of the orbit without knowing how the planet moves along it as a function of time. So that would be really an advantage. And either way, this is something that we will try. So there we go. Now, if R depends on time in this way, then according to the chain rule, if I take the derivative of R with respect to time, I would to first take the derivative with respect to the angle, and then the angle with respect to time. And now we can use this result over here. This is theta prime, so I can eliminate that and write the right hand side of 4. That is this, and I still had that the R d theta, and that I have written as the last vector, because these are just numbers multiplying, so that commutes. So that is straightforward. But now you can interpret this, given again the fact that you consider R to be a function of theta. You can say, well, if I have here a function that I take the derivative of with respect to R, and then R with respect to theta, that is the same by the chain rule backwards as saying, well, I take the derivative of 1 over R with respect to theta. So this is Kepler's law used, and this is the chain rule there for this expression, reading again R as a function of theta. And then 1 over R is also a function of theta, and by the chain rule you have this related to that. So that works, and that could be used to, for example, eliminate this R prime, but we already used equation 2, so we are now concentrating on equation 1. So we try to expand this and try to develop something to eliminate this R double prime here. So the derivative of time, we try to get rid of those time derivatives and write it in terms of a derivative with respect to the angle rather. And is that possible? Because it is possible in 5, so is that also possible for a second order derivative? Now there we go. So we take another time, the derivative with respect to time, once more. That would give the second order derivative with respect to time of this thing. And that was this. And how do we do? Well, again, by the chain rule. So we say we take first the derivative with respect to theta, and then theta with respect to time. Now this is a constant, there was already a first derivative with respect to theta, so now I get a second derivative with respect to theta, and theta with respect to time. So this would be the derivative with respect to time of this, and that would then be the second order derivative with respect to time of R. And we apply here the chain rule to have it done, given the fact that this is a function of r and that depends on time only through theta. So this is that. And now again I have that theta prime over there that I can again eliminate using Kepler's law. So that is why you get L over m squared, that comes from substituting this theta prime for this. L over m squared and the second order derivative with respect of 1 over r that becomes and actually we use this one, not this, but the first step to eliminate it. So you get 1 over r squared here and you keep this minus because there's no minus in relation 3. So this elimination of theta prime is by application of relation number 3 here. But the result expression 6 is that we can indeed rewrite the second order derivative with respect to time of r in terms of this intermediate derivative with respect to theta only. And all the primes have disappeared in 6, so actually we don't need to know the derivatives with respect to time. And so if you substitute that result 3 and 6 into equation 1, you can eliminate these double primes for r and the first prime theta, and you get this expression that is just substitution. And now multiply by m squared l squared and minus and by r squared. You get this, and the left hand side takes this form. And that is a wonderful, very beautiful result, because what is it? Let's copy this to the next slide. So what is in the box here? It will resurface at the next slide. So here it is. So it is derived from these. We derive this. And that is a wonderful result, because the left-hand side really is the harmonic equation. So that is a very beautiful thing, that in the motion of the heavens, at its heart, according to Newton's dynamics, is described by the harmonic equation, if you read that as an equation for the variable 1 over r that is here. So if you need that, you could substitute now for 1 over r new variable u, and then you see that the left-hand side of that equation 7 would just be the harmonic equation if the right-hand side would be linear, and that can be arranged, that can even be arranged to be constant, that can be arranged to be constant if we choose f of r, so the radial component of f, to be exactly 1 proportional to 1 over r squared, then this r squared would cancel, the right hand side of equation 7 would just be a constant. And then equation 7 would reduce to harmonic equation for 1 over r. And that would mean that equation would have periodic solutions for 1 over r, and hence also for r as a function of the angle. And if it is a periodic solution, you have a closed orbit. And as it turns out to be, if you solve that, but it's not very difficult, it is just solving the harmonic equation with a constant forcing term at the right-hand side, so a non-homogeneous harmonic equation, you get the solution that is in this lower box for 1 over r. And if you study that and compare it to basic properties of ellipses, you will see, you can easily prove that is the equation of an ellipse. That is the equation of an ellipse. By the way, if you solve a harmonic equation, you are probably used, we are used to say, well, that is the arbitrary superposition of a cosine and a sine. This may look a little bit different, but it is also at first sight, because this cosine is the cosine of the variable theta minus a constant. And if you use the rule for cosine of a sum of two angles, you will see that this is the cosine of theta times the cosine of the constant plus the sine of theta times the sine of that constant theta zero. So it is really a weighted sum of cosines and sines. This is just rewritten using the rules for a sum, cosine of a sum. And that means you can interpret this as the cosine of theta with the, and the starting value of the angle theta can be shifted by this constant of integration theta zero. That is what it is. And that is a second order equation, so you should have another constant of integration, and that is this epsilon. But by rewriting the solution in this way, you have it in a nice way that fits the description of ellipses. The quantity epsilon here is the eccentricity of the ellipse, the amount in which it deviates from being a circle. We will have a formula for that in a minute. But the message really is that Newton could recover from his dynamics Kepler's first law, the statement that planets move in elliptical orbits, if he chose for the radial dependence of the gravitational force, the pull between the planets, he chose that to be inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the planets. And here it is in his Principia. He writes that the force is inversely as the square of the distances of the places of the planets from the center. And this is about the motions of the moons of Jupiter. Those are the circumjovial planets. Those are the moons of Jupiter. He writes it there. And also for the primary planets, the planets that move in orbits about the sun. So Venus, Mercury, Mars, the Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, planets that were known, and the motions of which were known in his days. And he spends some text describing that this result must actually hold very accurately, that the force must be very accurately inversely proportional to or squared, because if it wouldn't, then the elliptical motions of the planets themselves would tilt a little bit. And those ellipses had been observed over years and years, and over many, many times their periods. So it was known quite with great accuracy that those ellipses themselves are lying stable with respect to the distant stars. And that would not be if the force would not be exactly 1/r². And Newton makes a remark here that the deviations, the motion of the ellipses themselves would have been observed, because their orientation with respect to the stars had been observed over longer periods, and it was known that those ellipses are stationary with respect to the distant stars. So he comes up here with a rather modern criterion for accurate observations in astronomy, and that is mentioned here.
To give a general solution of Newton's equations of motion would be really difficult, when the gravitational force would differ from being inversely proportional to the square of distance. But we can solve initial value problems in these cases by a numerical computation. In this way, we can rather easily plot individual orbits. The simulation now shown shows what the orbits of a planet would look like if the gravitational force would depend on distance according to the power p shown. Note that we vary this power only 0.5% away from its true value, 2. And even with these small deviations of this power from 2, we see that it would readily become apparent that the orbit would not be a closed cycle, and it would not be a stationary ellipse. And this or so it seems if one reads the Principia, was Newton's favorite argument. In favor of the gravitational force between two masses, to be inversely proportional to the square of the distance. We also notice the Platonic character of Newton's argument here. As compared to the alternatives, the ellipses are ideal shapes. And Newton uses this as an argument to decide on the dependence on distance of gravitational attraction between two masses. At the same time, Newton is very aware that pure ellipses will never be observed in practice, because pure ellipses would only occur if there really were only two-point masses in the universe. And so the setting of Newton's reasoning is rather Platonic indeed. For the sake of his argument, Newton imagines a universe which contains only two-point masses, and which is otherwise empty.
All right, so far so good. So let's proceed with how Newton interpreted Kepler's third law that was published actually in 1619. And this is a citation of Kepler's third law as quoted by Newton in the Principia. It goes like this. It is about the periodic time, so the full times that it takes for a planet to complete one full orbit, as compared to the distance from the Sun. And the ratio between that is such that the square of the orbital time, the full time of an orbit, is proportional to the third power of the distance to the Sun, so the mean distance from the Sun. And there is an extensive table here for all the planets, what those periodic times would be, and what the mean distances of the planets and the Earth from the Sun would be. And so that is quoted for all the planets, and that is the law, that the square of the orbital time, the total time for an orbit, is proportional to the third power of the major axis of the ellipse, we would say. Now, kind of reconstructed from the solution that we had. So as I told you, we did find this solution, and I told you just that is an equation for an ellipse. And if you combine that with some standard formulas for an ellipse of major axis A, minor axis B, eccentricity epsilon, and here's the relation between AB and epsilon, the area of such an ellipse would be pi AB. Now, this is the equation that we did get for an orbit of a particle and planet around to the Sun. And if you combine it, you come to the conclusion this number, the major axis times this expression in terms of the eccentricity, would be given by these parameters of Newton's equation, including the angular momentum L, that is assumed to be constant and would in principle be an observable. And then there's the equivalent mass here and the arbitrary constant K that we have not determined yet, but that is. So the gravitational force would be inversely proportional to r squared, and the constant of proportionality, that is that k. So that is how that came about. So this would be our theoretical result so far. Now, this total area of an ellipse, that can be related to Kepler's second law, because we interpret the left-hand side of the conservation of angular momentum, that is in this green box again, this r squared theta prime is the amount of area that is swept out per unit of time. And you can integrate that over a full over time and then over a full circle and then over a full orbit. And that means that in that full period, the full area is swept out. So you can relate by integration. And if you can try to do it for yourself, and if it turns out to be hard, you can have a look in the reader. I have it in full detail in the reader that comes with this episode, but you can then calculate that the full area of an ellipse should be related to the full period according to this expression for the conservation of angular momentum by this quantity. Now, in combining all these results that on the slide, you can actually come up with this relation in the green box down here that has a thick line around it, that does relate t squared, as predicted by Kepler's third law, to the third power of the length of the major axis of the ellipse of the orbit by this quantity. And let's copy that to the next slide to see if we can celebrate that, because this is then the result that you get from Newton's theory. This is Kepler's law, so that looks promising and very similar. However, Kepler's law says that this law, the third law of Kepler, holds for all the planets regardless of their mass. It says that the period of an orbit can be calculated from the distance only, but you don't have to know the mass of the planet. And the masses of the planets differ very substantially, so that is quite a statement. Whereas in Newton's theoretical results so far, we still have the mass of the planet. So these two results can only be reconciled. Those would only be consistent if we can somehow explain that this k must be proportional to that m, so that the dependence of m would exactly cancel. Now we come to the real genius of Newton, I would say. Let's see how Newton actually derived then what is called his universal law of gravitation, coming up with an argument really explaining why this and how this should come out right, and it really tells us something about it really shows us what Newton's theory really says about what the structure of gravitation is, and because this is a course for aerospace engineering, and because the gravitational field is really the field in which you are navigating if you do space travel, I think we should go for it, even though it is not strictly speaking an exercise in differential equations. But here we go. So the result that we had so far is that Newton's dynamics combined with Kepler's first and second law says gravitational field is central, and its dependence on the dependence of its radial component is such that it is proportional to 1 over r squared. Now, one of the brilliant ideas that Newton had was to interpret the motion of the moon around the Earth, for example, as falling. He said the motion of the moon is really, it falls while it also moves in that direction, and it is falling constantly towards the Earth. So he did interpret gravitational attraction of the Earth on the moon as the same kind of force by means of which objects fall in our daily environment. And about falling, it is easier nowadays, and especially for aerospace people, because we have experience and have seen in reports from space missions and space stations the observation of the phenomenon of weightlessness. So if during an unpropelled space flight you are inside the spacecraft, you have this phenomenon of everything becomes weightless and everything is floating around. Now that is to be interpreted as follows. In fact, under the influence of external gravity, that spacecraft is falling, but everything in it is falling with it in exactly the same manner. And because everything falls together in exactly the same manner, you get this impression and the circumstance, the phenomenon, that things do not collide anymore, but just fall together. And you get this phenomenon of what we experience as weightlessness. Things don't fall. It appears as if things don't fall, but what really happens is they fall together in exactly the same way, and not with respect to one another. That is what you really observe, and how that is to be interpreted. But the important detail of that is that apparently everything falls in exactly the same way, and it does not depend on the mass of things. Heavy things fall in the same way in vacuum as light things, and nor does it depend on the chemical composition or whatever. It doesn't depend on anything. So the acceleration under the influence of gravity is a given. That it doesn't depend on anything. It just depends on the position of where things are. And that is this statement. Acceleration under the influence of gravity, that is written by a symbol G, is just a given quantity. It doesn't depend on the body that is falling in any way. So that allows us to calculate the gravitational force acting on a body from the general second law of Newton himself. And that is this F. The force would be proportional to the change of amount of motion. So that is the mass times the acceleration. And that acceleration is a given. So that is now explicitly written as the gravitation, the acceleration of gravity, that is G. So the force acting on any body in vacuum, and in vacuum there's no disturbing of this process by friction or whatever, so everything is free falling, and then the gravitational force can really be calculated from the given acceleration of gravity, that is the G, and the inertia of the body. And it is really inertia because we really apply here the first law of Newton, and that was the rate of change of motion, and mass is really the property of bodies to resist against change of motion. This is really inertia mass here. So that's a nice result, that we can actually really calculate the force of gravity from the fact that we know that the gravitational acceleration is really a given quantity. That is the same for any body, and that is what is emphasized here. So if I would have two objects, let's say the sun and a planet, particle 1 and particle 2, what would be the force of particle 1 on particle 2? Well, apparently that would be proportional to the inertia of particle 2 times the acceleration that particle 2 experiences, and that depends only on position and not on anything else, because the acceleration doesn't depend on any property of the body. Now if we combine that with the expression for gravitational acceleration that we had, that it should be proportional to 1 over r squared, then we can substitute that, multiply by r squared both sides, and you get this. So then we can calculate that k as well, as it is applicable to this situation of a first particle acting on a second one. Now, Kay was a constant of integration during the process of working with Theta and R, so K may not depend on R. And that G, acceleration of gravitation, may not depend on the mass. And that means that this combination G2 times R squared must be a constant and that cannot depend on the mass. And why must it be a constant? Well, because K is a constant. So for K to be a constant that does not depend on R, this combination may not depend on R. So that must be constant. And G may not depend on the mass. So that constant may not depend on the mass of particle 2. And that is, I have an explicit notation for that. That bar over M2 means it does not depend on that. So we have this K. K is M2 times that, this is that C. So this is the result. We could substitute that back into this first relation, and it has been applied to the force by particle 1 on particle 2. And the result is over here, F12, and the absolute value of that, regardless of the sign, is the mass of that second particle times a constant that does not depend on that mass and inversely proportional to R squared. So it says that the gravitational force exerted by a first particle on a second particle and as experienced by that second particle is really just linear in the inertial mass of the second particle. That is really inertia. Now, likewise, so that result is copied over here, but likewise we could think about the force that is then also exerted by the second particle and on the first particle, because the third law of Newton said that must be there. And the reasoning would be exactly the same, and you get exactly the same result. The force by the second particle on the first particle, ignoring the sign, so the absolute value, would be just proportional to the mass of that particle that the force acts upon, times a constant, a different constant maybe, but it should not depend on M1 in this case, and it is again inversely proportional to the distance between the two particles. Now these two results can be combined with Newton's third law that says those two forces must be equal in strength. They are already opposite, but they must be equal in strength. So here we go. And because the distance from one to the other is equal to the distance from the other to one, that cancels if you put these things equal. So you get this identity that the mass times d is the second mass times c. Now, from that it follows if you divide by the mass, which is non-zero, so we can safely do that, that the quantity d that does not depend on the mass of the first particle is the mass of the second one divided by the mass of the first one times another constant that does not depend on the mass of the second particle. And now we again have a relation that is a little bit similar to the reasoning that we applied with the method of separation of variables, which say, well, the left-hand side does not depend on M1, yet those two quantities must be equal, and the right-hand side should also not depend on M1. And that implies that we are forced to the conclusion that the CM2 is linearly proportional to M1. That is in this box. But it must not depend on M2. And it also must be a constant in terms of the coordinates R and theta. So this proportionality constant G doesn't depend on anything anymore. It cannot depend on the variables R and theta because C cannot. And it cannot depend on M2 because C does not. And C it just has to be linearly proportional to M1. So G can also no longer depend on M1. So that is a genuine constant, a real constant that does not depend on anything. It's just a number. And with that we have found an expression for C. So that is copied here together with the expression that we had for F. This one. Proportional to M2 times that C. And C we have, and if we substitute, you get this expression, which is that is Newton's universal law of gravitation, that says the gravitational force is inversely proportional to the distance squared between two particles, and it is proportional to both of their masses. And there's another additional real constant that doesn't depend on anything, that is a real constant, a universal constant of nature. But now, if you realize what we have derived, both mass M1 and mass M2 are really inertial masses. They both entered the derivation as being the constant of proportionality of inertia. They both entered the theory here, saying, well, it is a means to calculate the force that acts, and the force is equal to the inertia times the acceleration. So both M1 and M2 are inertias. So the statement is here that the gravitational force that is exerted by the sun on a planet is proportional to the inertia of the sun. And that is really an astonishing result. Because why would that be? So the inertia is redefined as the property that if I push something, that object has a kind of a resistance against that acceleration. So I have to push in order to change its motion. But why would that property and that constant of proportionality, that is its inertial mass? But why would the inertia of the sun be kind of a cause? Why would the gravitational force that the sun exerts on a distant planet be proportional to the inertia of the sun? And that as well, that is exactly what we inescapably get out of this reasoning. So there's an inescapable and a really astonishing result that the gravitational force exerted by the sun on a planet is not only proportional to the inertia of the planet, but it is also proportional to the inertia of the sun. And this is a logical consequence, as we see, of the third law of Newton, of the fact that we set these two forces equal to one another. That is the reason why you derived that. What happened here? So the fact that the gravitational force exerted by the sun is proportional to the inertia of the sun is a direct logical consequence of the third law of Newton. And once again, it is maybe something that students understand easier than more experienced people, because students tend to wonder, how is it possible that we compare and add vectors over distance? And that is actually what Newton's third law does. It says two forces are equal to one another and opposite to one another, while the forces are actually defined at different places in space. And that is not at all what we do in linear algebra. In linear algebra we know vectors, but those are defined with respect to the coordinate system that is here. All the vectors are defined with respect to the same system of reference, the same coordinate system, and those we can add. But what happens in the third law is adding vectors that are defined essentially in different coordinate systems. So that is, mathematically speaking, not at all the same as what we do with vectors in linear algebra. It is something new. And here we see that that has really consequences, namely the consequence that the gravitational force exerted by a body is proportional to the inertia of that body. An interesting detail is that Newton did not celebrate and sell out this particular consequence of his theory. I'm quite sure that he was aware of it, and Newton proved everything. But this fact is proven in the Principia, but it is done in a way with cross references between theorems that are quite wide apart in the books. The Principia 3 books, and he's cross-referencing quite a bit between all kind of results, and then finally this is proven by that. But the fact that the force of gravitation exerted by the sun is actually proportional to the inertia of the sun is buried in the Principia. He did not really celebrate it, put it in the spotlights, and I can imagine that he did that because he was uncomfortable about the upcoming discussions that would give rise to. So that's an interesting detail about that. And that's the story of Newton's universal law of gravitation. We have really derived that now. Now, last detail, now that we have a result for K, so now we know that K is actually the universal constant times the masses of the two participating particles. You can now substitute that in the result that we had from Newton's mechanics for Kepler's third law. And now you have to take into account that this mass over here is actually the equivalent mass. So that is to be constructed during the preparations. So we'll look in my reader. And then combining all that, you find for a theoretical result from Newton's theory for Kepler's third law, this expression that says, well, actually there is a proportional relation between t squared and a cube, but the mass does appear here of both the sum of both the particles. But in practice, one of those masses, if you apply this to planets, one of those masses is the sun and the other is a planet, and the mass of the sun completely dominates this sun. The mass of the sun is so much bigger than the masses of all the planets that this sun is really can be replaced by the mass of the sun itself, and then the orbital times of the planets in that approximation no longer indeed depend on the mass of the planet. And that is how in very good approximation you can derive this third law of Kepler. All right. Now, that's the last result that I want to briefly quote to bring things to a conclusion. So we have now the gravitational force, and now you might recognize that can be written actually as a derivative with respect to R, and that's a gradient in polar coordinates. So the gravitational force is a conservative force in the sense that you learned in the course on the calculus in the first year of the bachelor program. It's a gravitational force, and this quantity over here is called the potential energy, the gravitational potential. And then again, starting from Newton's first dynamic equation, you can replace this right-hand side, that is the force in gravitational force in the radial direction, by this gradient here, derivative of R. And if you then would multiply again that equation by R prime, that would serve as an integrating factor, and then you can derive the conservation of total mechanical energy. So that is a derived consequence from the fact that the gravitational force is a conservative force, and again by the standard, not standard, but familiar techniques of differential equations, you could then prove and derive that there's another conservation law. So there's conservation of angular momentum, that is what we had. Here's another one, conservation of energy. And again, that is profitable, because if you now again use Kepler's second law to get rid of the theta prime, to eliminate the theta prime in terms of R, you get this expression. And it only now contains R and R prime. So that can be read as a differential, first order differential equation. It's very nonlinear again, but it's a first order differential equation for R as a function of time. And you could try to integrate that to find the position along an orbit as a function of time. You would first find R as a function of time, and then given that you find the differential equation for theta as a function of time, and if you integrate that, you could find the motion of a spacecraft or a planet as a function of time in its orbit. But I will not go into the details of that, because that is really a specialism in aerospace engineering. So you will probably know this from other courses. I just want to quote a famous solution by Bessel in a letter in 1818 to a friend, Mr. Olbers. And again, he presents a solution in terms of a coordinate that you probably know from Introduction to Aerospace Engineering. It's called the eccentric anomaly. It is an alternative coordinate for an ellipse here. So this eccentric is this psi here, and it is related to the radius in terms of the major axis and eccentricity of the ellipse in this way. And then Bessel also uses a scaled notion of time, that is this tau. It is scaled by angular frequency that is related to the angular momentum of a planet in its orbit, and the geometrical parameters of that ellipse, the orbit, and m, this nice relation. And in terms of that, here is the solution of Bessel that Bessel wrote to his letter, to his friend in that letter, and it is like this. And actually Bessel expressed being surprised that nobody had found this solution before him, and he didn't even bother to publish it. And it is this solution, it is an infinite sine series actually. So this is a Fourier series. So we once again see a Fourier series describing the motion of a planet as a function of time in its orbit. And the coefficients of that Fourier series are Bessel functions of all kinds of order, and you sum over the order and integer orders. So these integer, and these functions are Bessel functions, and those are, they are actually solutions of Bessel's equation, the very one that we studied. And this again shows that it is exactly the integer orders of Bessel's equation that and the solutions of that for integer orders that surface in this expression that plays a key role in how planets move and how spacecraft move in their orbits. So we see all the integer order Bessel functions here appearing, and that is exactly the case that you would study if you would solve the differential equations to find out details of this function. You would solve Bessel's equation by a Frobenius method in order to figure out come up with the diagnosis of such functions, for example, in the neighborhood of the irregular singular points. So, that is, I think, a nice result to quote, because it ties together all kind of results that we have met in the course of this series of episodes. Fourier series with Bessel functions of integer order as coefficients describing the motion of a Kepler orbits as a function of time. All right, time to wrap up. We have really come full circle in this final episode. We studied Newton's Principia, going to really the genesis of differential equations, because his were the very first differential equations that were ever proposed in with these enormous consequences. And that really started the whole studies and development of theory of differential equations. Now, from the very start on, it was a system of nonlinear differential equations. So that what we saw today, there is hardly a general methodology in contrast with linear theories. If you compare what happened in this episode to what we got used to in all the previous episodes, bringing in all kind of ideas from linear algebra, none of that today. So you have to really find your way. And I just want to remind you that once again, what we saw today has really been the product of great minds that have been working on this at least since the 17th century. So if you feel this is impressive, now it is, but this has been a product of hard work by great minds over 300 years. And but still today we saw some key players from earlier episodes of this course reappearing, like integrating factors, the harmonic equation that turned out to be at the heart of the solution of orbital motions of planets. We cancel Fourier series, we cancel Bessel's functions. And now given all this, I hope to have given some idea of how it could be that Newton's approach and his thinking can have been enabling to consider that as a completion of the scientific revolution, and why from then on scientists and intellectuals and were stimulated to try similar type of reasonings and similar types of approach, and how that could be so successful that it might even can be considered as foreshadowing the Industrial Revolution, with all the consequences that we may observe only looking at, for example, the graph of the population on Earth. Well, by all this and everything else that we covered in the course of all these episodes serve you as well in your career, and with that may it serve you to establish everything that you have in mind that you want to establish working in aerospace engineering or whatever you would like to do after finishing your studies. So may all this serve you well, I hope. And well, this being the last episode of this course, thank you very much for attending this and for interacting with me. I really, as I announced, it's always a pleasure to present this wonderful material to the wonderful and very interesting audience that aerospace engineers make, being attracting from all over the world to come study this with us. So thank you very much. And with that, once again, I call this an episode.
Thank you. My pleasure.